Does it work?
Good morning and welcome to Woodland Presbyterian Church. Steve, I know, has an announcement.
If I'm turned on, there we go. Zephyr Point update. Everything is on track. We've sold out all 20 rooms. Yay! We don't have to turn any rooms back. But if there's still someone out there still thinking about going, we're still able to add a room or two to our list. We did it last year, and we'd love to do it again this year. Wow, I think I used the word still 6 times in that paragraph. Anyway, don't be the one to miss out on this great experience this July, because I do not want to be the one to say, I told you. Oh, by the way, did I mention that we'll have bounce houses and a cotton candy machine and a snow cone machine and a popcorn machine and a churro maker and glass beads, face painting? And yeah, I probably already told you, yeah. Thanks for listening. Everybody can go home now.
Are there any other announcements? Yes, Karen.
Just because it's not in the bulletin, just a reminder that if y'all like to sing, but just not in front of the entire congregation, we are doing a karaoke night. It's coming up the last Saturday of this month. It'll be 6 to 7:30. I don't think it made it in the bulletin, but it will be in the leaves. Last year, what I do is I just bring in my laptop and we hook it up to the sound system. And then you can YouTube just about any karaoke song you could ever think of. Songs from the 20s, jazz songs, gospel songs. The kids love it. You know how when they sit up here during children's sermon, they keep trying to steal the mic? These kiddos, they don't like to sing during children's choir, but they love to sing along with YouTube and during karaoke night. So please join us. It's open to anyone who wishes to belt out their favorite song. That is Saturday, last Saturday in April, 6 to 7:30, right here.
Are there any other announcements? Our freezer needs defrosting, and it takes at least 2 people for that and maybe 4 hours.
So if you want to come and shift, somebody help me move it into the scullery where there's a drain, and somebody else come later. I'm available most days, so if anybody can help, come let me know. Thank you.
For anyone who's not aware, I want to introduce our very special guest speaker today, Steve Silvera, our very own, who has volunteered to give the sermon and lead the service in Mike's absence. Just a warning, I forgot my reading glasses today. So if I stumble and mumble a bit, I'll have an excuse. Please join me in the call to worship. Praise to the Lord God Almighty, who is and was and evermore shall be. Glory be to the Father, for Christ came to bring us truth and love. We are to share these with all who will hear the good news. For in our shaping, God's blessing continues and is multiplied. Let our hearts be filled with joy for the blessings of God. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Please rise as you are able and join us in hymn 33, Praise the Lord, God's Glory Show. The proof of God's amazing love is this. While we were sinners, Christ died for us. Because we have faith in him, we dare to approach God with confidence. Let us confess our sins before God. Lord, sometimes, like most children, we tend to think we are the source of our truth and wisdom, instead of acknowledging that you are the source and that you are love itself. Forgive us, Lord, and help us plant our roots in the reality that you are truly God, our only source of genuine love, and we are your children only by your grace and mercy. In Christ we pray, amen. Please continue in silent prayer and your own personal confession. Hear the good news. If we have died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. Friends, believe the good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Hallelujah. Amen. I believe, has the children's sermon. So all the kids come forward.
Change it up on you. I'm going to sit here. So then you're going to turn around and face me here. A new beautiful face. Can you tell me your name?
Sarah.
Hi, Sarah. I have an aunt named Sarah. All right, boys, can you turn around here? I had a really neat sermon, and I made 12 because I was just certain that we were going to have 12 today. So glad you're here, Sarah. Okay, I have some pictures to show you. You ready?
Hello.
No.
That's why I handed it to you. So I have some pictures I want to share with you. What do you see?
Mountains.
Yes. What do you see?
Do you see anything today? Grass.
Grass, yes.
A lake.
A lake. Yeah, and there's people on a river, and there's people hiking. And look at the rainforest.
Ooh. Wow!
Yeah. And look at these. These are really wow. Big bingos.
Bingos.
Nope. Okay, I'm going to take that back. That'll
yeah,
solve our problem.
There
we go. All right, I have another one. This one kind of makes me sad. You guys ready? Are you sure? Okay. What do you see now?
A bunch of trash polluting the nature.
Yeah, do you see that trash in the forest? I love to hike in a forest, but I don't want to hike like that. What do you see?
A boat.
Yeah. Smog. Oh, smog. Yes, there's a boat. But in the background, the sky is really, really foggy. But that's smog. It's pollution. I wouldn't want to breathe that. What do you see?
Wood broke down.
Yes, I see like piles of wood broken down. Yes, looks like some driftwood with a bunch of trash. Okay, Sarah, can you hold this one for me? And Katie, would you hold this one for me? Nope, wrong one. Have them in order. And you hold that one? Okay, let's hold them so you everybody can look at them. Especially you three. Which of those worlds do you think God made? This one or this one? What do you think?
The not trash world.
Yes, he made the part that was not trashed. Well, what do you think about this? How do you feel about looking at all that trash in God's world?
Mad at the people that did that.
Yeah, I'm kind of great cranky with them too. Well, what do you think God thinks about his world being trashed? What do you think about that? What do you think God thinks? What do you think God thinks? Sarah's got an idea? All right. What do you think?
I think God's mad too.
Yeah, I bet he's pretty cranky with us right now with our trash in our world. So I have one more picture to show you, so you can hand me those back. Oh, I love getting loves. You know what? My 28-year-old still gives me hugs. It's nice. You gonna hold that for me? Okay, that's okay. All right, now look at this picture right here. What do we see happening here? Sarah's got an idea, Ham's got an idea. Kaden's still thinking, that's okay.
Picking up the trash.
I like your rhythm. What do you see?
I see people picking up all of the trash so that the beaches aren't filled
with trash. No. So that's something we can do. Look at this. I went to the city and I said, I'm going to talk to kids about Earth Day. And look at this. They gave me this really neat recycle bag that I can use when I go to the store. And so we could pick up trash, right? So is that something we can do? Does anybody have another idea of what we can do to make the world a better place of God's world that he made for us? Sarah.
You can, inspire people to help you pick up trash and, stop people from cutting down trees so the animals can still have their homes.
Oh my gosh, are you going to be an ecologist, environmentalist, save the world?
No.
I wish I vote for you. Yes, Hamilton.
I'm going to save all the animals from their homes getting cut down.
I love it. I love it. That makes my teacher heart happy. All right. We can also turn off the water when we brush our teeth, right? We can recycle, like, how many of you recycle your cans and bottles?
Yes.
Yes? Yep. You do that? Yep.
Yes, Sarah?
My class, in my school, we give all the other classes recycle boxes, and then every Friday we come and pick them up and put them in the big recycle dump.
I love it. You guys are already doing what we need to do. So guess what? I have some. See how this is all filled? I thought there was going to be 12 of you. I'm going to save them for next time. So in here are recycled bags. All right, and in these recycled bags are recycled bags, and there's stickers that you can put on these bags and decorate them so you can make your own trash bag. Does that sound cool? And if that's not stupendous enough, I also have coloring books about how you can save the world. Awesome. So after we say our prayer, which is going to start now, we're going to go outside. I'm going to give you your bag, and you get to choose your own coloring book. How does that sound? Say, yay. I love it. Okay. Okay, are you ready? We're going to sit right here. It's all huddled together. Heavenly Father, thank you for the beautiful world that you created for us to enjoy. We promise to take better care of our world. Thank you for blessing us of the children that are here today. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. Thank you. I'll meet you outside that door. And anybody who didn't want to come up can still get one too.
That's going to be a tough act to follow. Morning, everyone. Happy day before Earth Day. I know all you people are waiting for my joke, you know. Pastor Mike never tells them, so. This joke is referring to a person who's no longer with us, but he was loved by many. So, Billy Graham was at the airport returning from a speaking engagement, and a limousine was waiting there to take him home. He mentioned to the driver that he had been riding in limos all his life, but never had driven one. And asked the driver if he'd be all right to drive this one for a little while. Well, the driver agreed. What was he going to do, say no to Billy Graham? And so after a short distance from the airport, a rookie state trooper operating his first ever speed trap pulled the limo over for going 70 miles an hour in a 55 mile an hour zone. Upon observing who the driver was, the very nervous trooper returned to his car and in a very shaky voice called the supervisor and says, I don't know what to do. I think that I just pulled over a very, very important person. The supervisor asked, well, who is it? The young trooper stumbled over his words and said, I think it's Jesus. The supervisor yelled back at him, well, why in the world would you think that? Because, this trooper said, he's got the Reverend Billy Graham as his chauffeur. Let's pray before the scripture reading. O God, lover of humanity, joy of creation, pour out your spirit on us that we may hear your ancient words in a new key with newer meaning. Inspire us to sing your praises in every land and with every generation. Startle us, O God, with your truth and open our hearts to your word that hearing we may believe. And believing, we may trust you with our lives. In Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our scripture readings for this morning are Psalms 24, 1 through 2, and Psalm 96, 11 and 12. The earth is the Lord's, and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. For he founded it upon the seas and established it upon the waters. Let the heavens rejoice, let the earth be glad. Let the sea resound and all that is in it. Let the fields be jubilant and everything in them. Then all the trees of the forest will sing for joy. This is the word of the Lord. After preparing my sermon, I found this, and I would like to read it before the sermon. The author is unknown. It's called An End to Waste. Let us pray for an end to the waste and desecration of God's creation, for access to the fruits of creation to be shared equally among all people, and for communities and nations to find sustenance in the truths and fruits of the earth and the water God has given us. Almighty God, you created the world and gave it into our care so that in obedience to you, we might save all people. Inspire us to use the riches of creation and wisdom and to ensure that their blessings are shared by all, that trusting in your bounty, all people may be empowered to seek freedom from poverty, famine, and oppression. We're all Christians. We believe that Jesus Christ came into this world as the incarnation of the Creator God among us. At the very least, that suggests that the world he made and in which he lived is a good and lovely place, which, given half a chance, will continue to feed our souls with beauty and provide for our children after us. We do not inherit the earth from the past. We borrow it from them, the children. Whose earth is it? The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. Tomorrow's Earth Day. What is Earth Day, you ask? Wikipedia states that Earth Day is an annual event held every April 22nd to demonstrate support for environmental protection. First held on April 22nd, 1970, conceived of as an environmental teach-in by then Senator Gaylord Nelson. It includes a wide range of events coordinated globally by EarthDay.com, including over 1 billion, with a B, 1 billion people in nearly 200 countries. Earth Day in 1970 saw unprecedented unity among Republicans, Democrats, individuals from all social and economic backgrounds. Thanks to the Earth Day, the United States Environmental Protection Agency, the EPA, was founded, along with the Clean Air Act, the Clean Water Act, and the Endangered Species Act, 1970. Back when people disagreed with each other, but still got things done for the people and the environment. Some now would say the good old days. Some say maybe not. Topic for another day. Today we're discussing Earth Day 2024. For many of us, these past 3 weeks since Easter has felt kind of like the Super Bowl, a family wedding, and herding a giant field of cats all at the same time. A long 3 weeks indeed. The earth is the Lord's and all that is in it. Does it startle anyone here each summer, discovering the earth's fullness? I think that you have to live more than 5 decades or so for it to really get to you. I think that you have to live more than the amazing miracle of life in nature, the dependable fertile soil, the beautiful lush greenness that returns every year, year in and year out, like clockwork. We usually miss it for the first few decades of our lives. We're so busy, distracted. Then one day, this amazing miracle of the earth, our home, is right there in front of our eyes. Scenery and visions that we've seen time and time again finally comes into clear focus. Rolling green mountains as far as the eyes can see. The morning fog and the warmth of the sun. What could possibly damage all of this? It's too big, so fertile, so willing to provide food and shelter and energy and beauty for everyone. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it. But you know what? This place doesn't belong to us, you and me. The earth is the Creator's, God's. We are just allowed to live in it and to enjoy it and use its amazing productivity. But we don't own it, and so we are not free to do with it whatever we want. The problem is that we act like it's ours alone. And in the process, we seem to be creating some rather major problems for those who will come after us, our children, our grandchildren, and their children. Life will continue after we're gone. We all know that. And it's going to depend on how we leave this earth for those after us. How easy or how hard their lives are going to be will definitely be our choice as to how we decide as a congregation, as a town, as a state, as a country, as a world, how we leave the shape of this earth for future generations. The gift of Jesus Christ as a child in Bethlehem shows us this. God loves and blesses the world and human life by visiting it and becoming part of it, by living and dying in it, and then by rising again to redeem it. The whole of creation is groaning in anticipation, longing for its redemption and its salvation. So why is it then that some Christians don't seem to care that much? Some think that the real focus of our religion is really the next world and not this one. Some people think that the real focus of religion is really the next world and not this one. It does seem that way at times, does it not? That the real purpose of religion is to just get us into heaven and not be concerned about maintaining and improving things here on earth? A Yale study several years ago showed that the more religious that people are, the less they are inclined to care about the environment. I don't know about y'all, but that scares the bejeebers out of me. The most famous example you might remember was former Secretary of the Interior James Watt, an evangelical Christian who publicly stated that long-range conservation of natural resources was unnecessary because Jesus was coming again and the world would soon end, so why bother? Whatever the historical reason, it's now time for people of faith to reclaim both the gift, the amazing miracle of this earth, and to reclaim the responsibility that God has given to us. We are the ones, the only ones. We are much stronger than we think. We can make it or break it. The garden is ours to till and to tend, or ignore and destroy it. Earth Day is 54 years old tomorrow. Some say that Earth Day is experiencing a midlife crisis, a surface level holiday, one feel-good day to justify a year of consuming and polluting. I say that it's time we start to think of every day as Earth Day, because one thing is for certain, and that is that we still have much, much more work to do to protect our communities and God's creation. Now, what about those who do not see the turmoil of Mother Earth? Those that do not believe in climate change and triggers a response like that of the disciple Thomas after the resurrection of Jesus. You remember Doubting Thomas, as he was sometimes called in the Bible? Not only did Thomas say he needed to see Jesus to believe in the resurrection, but says he also needs to feel his wounds. Jesus always leads by example and showed them his wounds. Regardless of how gruesome, it could not have been easy to look upon those wounds of Christ, let alone touch them. So too it is with climate change. When we really look at the impacts of climate change, the images are painful. It's not just drowning polar bears that break our hearts, but also the struggles of our fellow humans. Women carrying children through waist-high floodwaters. Wildfire smoke visible from outer space. Pictures of bone-dry, parched earth. Yet we must face the fact that climate change is happening and is human-caused. There's more consensus among scientists that humans have caused climate change than there is in the medical field that smoking causes cancer. That's a pretty powerful statement. Unlike Doubting Thomas with Jesus, this present-day crisis is not a matter of believing. It is an issue that our faith calls upon us to address because we have a moral responsibility to do so. So how then do we invite in those who are blindly averting their eyes and hearts from this painful reality? One answer is to have a good messenger. For instance, like Sir David Attenborough. I'm sure a lot of people know who I'm talking about, but even if you don't know his name, I'll bet you would recognize his voice as the one behind numerous nature documentaries. A study released 1 year after his Blue Planet 2 series was released, single-use plastic consumption had been cut in half in the US and the UK. They are calling this the Attenborough effect. Attenborough is making waves through his position of influence. But what about those of us who are not a famous voice actor? Well, we're even better. We are the church. Together we form the body of Christ through which God is at work within the world through which all things are possible. As people of the resurrection tasked with tending God's garden, we are messengers that the world needs. To be honest, we'll probably end up having some hard conversations with some modern-day doubting Thomases. Don't let that scare you away from our core values. Value-based conversations and stories about creation are what will take root in people's hearts and their minds. What you say to someone tomorrow could move someone to treat every day as if it were Earth Day. And eventually, people will speak of the church effect, right there with the Attenborough effect, as some of the main reasons that restored God's creation. And all God's people said, amen. Take a minute and let that sink in. Now, are there any prayer requests, prayers of joy, prayers of healing? Thank you, Adrian.
Good morning. I'm just asking for prayers for my friend Belinda. She was one of my Camino angels when I walked in Spain 2 years ago. Her daughter Maria is suffering from leukemia with some really serious consequences. So prayers for Belinda and her daughter Maria.
Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our
prayers. Is it this morning?
I have one. If you could pray for Taya and myself, I am struggling to be the parent I would like to be for her, and she is struggling to be a four-year-old at this time. but in all seriousness, if you could just lift us up, I think we could use that.
Lord, in your mercy. Let us now turn to God with our prayers. The ministry of prayer is part of the baptismal calling of every believer. We pray for the world because God so loves it. We pray for the church because it is Christ's body, living and working in the world. God of the garden and God of our faith, we come to you today longing for your peace. Easter was just a few weeks ago, but the world already seems to be spinning faster. Already the sound of the trumpets and the echoes of Christ is risen are beginning to fade from our ears. So once again, we bring ourselves back to this space, hoping that like on Easter, we might catch a glimpse of you. Gracious God, we bring ourselves back to this space because like the disciples, we know what it is like to be afraid. Like the disciples, we know what it is to carry doubt. Just this week, violence continues in Haiti, Israel, Gaza, and in the Ukraine. Just this week, many of us have had conversations with friends and family about health scares, financial stress, and strained relationships. Just this week, we have longed to see your hands at work, Jesus. So as we look towards the days ahead with both gratitude and tenderness, remind us, Jesus, that we are not alone. Remind us that you stand among us. Remind us of the peace you offer us. Remind us of the scars on your hands and your body and the invitation we have to follow you until that promised day where the peace you offer takes up permanent residence here. We will continue to hope, we will continue to pray, uniting our voices in the words your Son taught us to pray, singing, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. That is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I would now invite the ushers to come forward and collect today's tithes and offerings. There you go. I think we will. Rise if you are able to sing I Love You, Lord, from hymn 627.
Thank you.
We must acknowledge that everything we have and enjoy, even the breath in our lungs, is a gift from you. In response to your goodness and steadfast love, we are called to respond in gratitude and generosity ourselves. You, O God, have blessed us with so much, and in our offering and subsequent prayer of dedication, we are returning a portion of those blessings back to you and providing them with the assurance that you will use them in the context of this church family to bring about your kingdom here on earth. We are thanking you, O precious God, offering our gifts and dedicating them for your purposes. Amen. Please remain standing and sing, "Make Me a Channel of Your Peace," number 753. Your covenant with all living things and our obligation to be good stewards of the gifts that you have provided. Help us to understand that each of us has an important role in caring for creation by the choices we make and by the actions we take. Give us the wisdom to choose thoughtfully and to act with care in accordance with your love and your love of this good earth. As we celebrate Earth Day tomorrow, let's do so with a heart of gratitude and a reverence for our own Creator. Let's commit to being good stewards of his creation, not out of a sense of obligation, but out of love and appreciation for the one who made it all. We can use this occasion to draw closer to you, O God, marveling at your handiwork and praising you for the beauty and majesty of the world you have created and given us. Deca Lourdes. Amen. Now, if we form a circle, we'll sing our final song, "Surely the Presence." Now, the bulletin says to be mindful of our neighbor and to not hold hands, but that'll be your individual decision.